sound like good and blow that thunder. I need a good number. I need a good number. Love my plug like I love my mama. I need a good number. You need a good. If Mike Vick do right, he'll get a good number. Probably buy another pit and a brand new Hummer. Me, I want a Dodge Ram or a black on black Tundra. 15 in the back, make it sound like thunder. Walmart beat Kroger, they got good number. It ain't nothing different from Culper to Corner. Had a partner pay a lawyer, a real good number. We'll face it 10 years and only did a summer. Uh-oh, that go Vito and that Hilltopper red. Don't get close to him, you'll hear what a Hilltopper said. I'm from George Fant, and where will it tag a player? You know what I mean when I say it, for real. I love my plug like I love my mama. I need a good number. I need a good number. Sell that good. Blow that thunder. I need a good number. I need a good number. Love my plug like I love my mama. Need a good number. I need a good number. Love my plug like I love my mama. I need a good number. I need a good number. Sell that good and blow that thunder. I need a good number. I need a good number. Love my plug like I love my mama. G-U-D-M-U-B-E-R. To get one of these, you gotta be a star. Kentucky Lottery. Pick 3, 2, 7 more. Man, get mine straight back, and I'm good to go. Feel like Obama, dealing with number. Won't pile in the street, hand them a good number. Okay, you gon' do you, I'm gon' do me. And then whatever that is, that come with a whole lot of weed. A gummy bear, nightmare, rats, you know who it is. They do it in the broad daylight. I love my plug like I love my mama. Not Jerry Springer, so far from drama, for real. Love my plug like I love my mama. Need a good number. Need a good number. Sell that good. Blow that thunder. Need a good number. Need a good number, Maxi. Love my plug like I love my mama. Need a good number. I need a good number. Love my plug like I love my mama. I need a good number. I need a good number. Sell that good and blow that thunder. I need a good number. I need a good number. Love my plug like I love my mama. I need a good number. Need a good number. Love my plug like I love my mama. Need a good number. I need a good number. Love my plug like I love my mama. I need a good number. I need a good.
And we in the building, y'all. Off the Cuff Radio. I'm your host, King Eric, the Media Assassin, and this show is sponsored by Screwball Radio, which you can check out every Saturday night. Buddy Boy Entertainment, Da Vinci Clothing. Got my host, T-Mance, with the facts in the building. What's good?
Man, what's going on, y'all? It's another tremendous chapter in the championship history of the most outstanding, the most ostentatious, the most we're just extra with it, but you love it. Fresh Frequency on the air, off the cuff radio. Shout out to our co-host, Sir Eli Sandman, LA Chinchilla. Of course, DJ Cynthia of Dirty Basement Radio up in New York City. And ladies and gentlemen, this is momentous. This is the precursor to a milestone. King, this is our 600th show.
Well, not really. 600 is going to
really,
be all... Yeah, we remixing it around a little bit, so to speak. You know what I mean? We rearranging things around a little bit. Originally passed that, but, you know, we had the technical difficulties we had to take care of. But we gonna count 600 Sunday. This is going to be probably 602. We're going to rearrange the puzzle a little bit.
Understood. But like you said, y'all, we're doing a celebration for our 600th on Sunday. Tune in, turn up with us, call to help us commemorate and celebrate. We couldn't have done it without you. You know, our audience and all our guests, you know, who have graced our show. We are so blessed. We are so humble. We are so appreciative. We love you all. We thank you all. King, we got a living legend of hip-hop royalty, a platinum-selling artist, an actor, and so many other talents. King, go ahead and bring them on in and let everybody know about who we got.
Yeah, man. First of all, big shout out to Angela for making this happen. This guy right here was a part of the Nappy Roots, one of the most prolific groups that came out in the 2000s. And now he's not only stretching his wings into the acting tip, but he's also
he's moving.
And he's here on Off the Cuff Radio to talk about his latest projects, what he has going on, to tell his story. So I welcome Big V for the Nappy Roots, y'all.
What's up, man? Weed smokers, get to it. What it do, man? Appreciate y'all sharing the platform with me, man.
Man, we appreciate you.
Man. So, man, catching up, man. High and tilted. Coming from my dispensary, man. Closing the last little part down of a nice day in Kentucky. And a pretty good day in the, you know, down in the country deep. Tell me about that West Coast thing, man. Let's catch up and do it.
Man, look.
Yes, sir.
Your credentials are just incredibly impeccable. You know, you're not only a part of one of the greatest groups ever in hip-hop history, coming in one of the greatest musical greatest musical decades, but like King said, you've expanded your already impressive portfolio into so many other avenues. You're a living legend, and on this show, we're so humbled and appreciative to have you on as another legend, you know, on our platform. There's a lot of history to get to. There's a lot to document. There's a lot to discuss. So we got to get to it, you know, off the starting blocks. You know, let the gun go bang, you know, and we got the smoke in terms of where we get the trails up, man. Go ahead and let everybody know about who you are.
Man, first of all, man, I wasn't one of my title really good, Daddy. Big Daddy to my grandboy. Grandgirl, man, XXL, top 10 rap boss of all time, Mr. All Now, Hill Now. All my life been told, king of barbecue music. And, man, I'm owning my own dispensary now, man. Really stressed the game out different. I had to leave Nappy Roots to raise my kid. And knowing 11 million people, man, I had to switch the game up, man. Expand what I was doing. And just back at it, man. Did a lot of movies, did a lot of writing. And just continuing to grow as a productive black man on his journey, you know?
You know, one thing about it, when we think about the Nappy Roots, of course, the hits you all have, the music in general that you all bought, it makes us recall, recollect, reminisce, remember a time in hip-hop where the art stood on its own. You know, this is before social media really became a thing at the time. I mean, you know, we really had Black Planet, you know, back in the day, MySpace, you know, you know, so it was, you know, so it was really about, and it was really about the organic reach, you know, magazines, you know, Source, XXL, Feds, Don Diva, you know, they were all instrumental in really helping to really give us an idea of what was coming next. It goes without saying that you all were one of the most impactful groups of the generation.
Yes,
tell everybody about how you got started in terms of, you know, your story in terms of who inspired you, how you began to rap, how the group came, you know, how things changed along the way, and then how you pretty much, you know, as we said, there's a lot to get to. When did you first fall in love with hip hop?
Man, when I first fell in love with hip hop, 1985, I was watching Crush Groove, and then Run pissed his brother off, and he said, There's a lot. We have a lot of entertainers on this stage tonight. But I want y'all to know one thing. You know, this is my motherfucking house. And, like, the freedom of that when I was 10 years old. And, like, I've tasted ever since. I fell in love with Big Daddy Kane's style and slogan in 88 with the flashed eyebrows. I seen Jay-Z's Hawaiian Sophie. And we, you know, all we had was television. So we've seen Rap City and MTV and the Fuse. Those were the three outlets. And being a kid, you know, like every kid with that basketball in the backyard, 3-2-1 and shoot it. And to actually get that shot. And to make it to one of those three spots. And to meet DMX and to actually run into Big Daddy Kane later and do concerts with him is only hip hop, you know. To give me that outreach, to give me that freedom as a young black man. So fell in love with it in 85 and just faced it. And, you know, when NWA took it out there and put Dickie Pants on him, and then Scarface and the Ghetto Boys told us to see in the trap down south. And then when 8-Ball MJG had it, and my grandparents being from Tennessee, it just stuck to me. And like 1991, 92, I didn't want to be anything else but a rapper. Graduated in 94. Left college to raise kids. And then 98, I signed a record deal with Atlantic Records with Nappy Roots. We were putting out tapes, doing shows, Chitlin' Circuit on the road with 8-Ball MJG, Trick Daddy, Soleil, JT Money, and learned how to really rock it, you know, through those years. All Now dropped in 01, and the rest was history after Nelly split the seat.
Now, when you think about it, at the time you all came out, in terms of what was going on, hip-hop was just, like you said, you know, you mentioned DMX.
Boom.
You know, you figure, your album, when your debut came out, this is a time when we're looking at Jay-Z, Nelly, 50 Cent, you know, everybody is in this mix right now.
50 wasn't out yet.
50 wasn't out yet. But he was still making noise. He was still making noise a little bit.
Yeah,
he was still making
coming.
Noise from How to
he
Rock.
He wasn't out yet.
He wasn't out yet.
Yeah,
he was coming.
He was on the way.
Yeah, he was on the way.
It
so
felt like
it's
a fucking hurricane, too, when he got there.
They
played in the club for 20 minutes. I was in New York when in the club dropped, and they played it for 20 minutes. And I danced for 17 before I realized that they playing this over and over. And it was just Jesus, you know, Lord have mercy. I've never been that drenched. And then when Jeezy come out, I'm a real nigga, and I don't like rappers.
Man, look.
Oh, man. And then hip-hop took its turn. She wanted bass. She wanted Molly. As Crit described with his country shit. And then after we dropped, Ludacris came out a month later with Chicken and Beer after Waterman and Chicken and Grit. So we had, in our process, coined the way for the new things to come. And this is right after Outkast got booed for winning.
Yeah.
You remember?
Yeah. That was the night, yeah, so, that was the 94 Source Awards,
So we get deals right after that. And so it was just the ashes of that. And to be right there with Outkast and to introduce you to great lines that here come T.I. and Jeezy's and Lil Wayne pulled the card off three, and now there's Drake and Nick to be a Southern act, and Rick Ross and everybody, plies, and everybody ready. And
it's like a boom.
The one that brought the thing through. And so to be a part of that and bring that fresh air back and get back to what we were doing, and me as a solo artist, like you heard me in a group, most cats don't even know yet.
Yeah. Take us through
and
that
shows too.
Go ahead.
I was just saying that it just goes to show too that you guys were so observant of all regions. Like y'all wasn't close to just one region. Y'all paid attention to everything, and that's what made your music sound fresh as it is.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And to be up top and to do shows in Rochester and learn how to snatch chains and Syracuse and then to go down to D.C. and get a piece of go-go and then Baltimore and then on the turnpikes in Philly as well as the boot in Louisiana. So back then, and you would travel and see the different places like Philly, famous for the beer, state property at that time, right?
Yeah. That era, because you all dropped your debut in 2002. So, you know, at this time, you know, there's the South is still kind of, because at that time, like you said, the, you know, when Outkast, the 94 Source Awards, because when we're looking where, and we're taking our listeners on a bit of the history, because we want them to really get a context of how far the South came. And with Outkast, when Andre 3000 famously said the South got something to say, it was definitely something where they were serving notice of what was to come. You know, people like Lil Jon, you know, down in Atlanta, a lot of people don't know that John was doing his DJ thing down there. And, you know, it was like 96 when he would really get out there in terms of the local scene really becoming big, although his debut wouldn't come until like 4 years later, I believe.
And John came through after us. And to be in some of the panels that John was speaking on, and to be one of those guys that listened to every word, and to break before he did, was kind of something, you know?
Yeah.
And, but to be a part of that and seeing Chris Lover go from that to Ludacris. So Nappy Roots opened those doors to where identity, where if you can do it just being you.
Now, one thing about it is when you all came out, you all had such a down-home, soulful vibe. You know, if Outkast was considered the Southern gentlemen, you all were the country cousin who really, really, really brought a soul food of stupendous spectacularness to it. You all had a fresh feast of a flow that was really organically grown with all types of feel good.
Yes, sir.
Did you know when Watermelon Chicken and Grits dropped, did you all know what you all had in the pot in terms of how it was going to become popular? Take us through that journey.
No.
Take us through that journey of take us through the journey of how you all came into, you know, getting signed with Atlantic, to the process, the creativity, and ultimately release of that.
Well, actually, we had our own mom and pop store as college students in first class, and people were just stealing our tapes. And the CD burner came out, and so we were burning and selling. And there was this cat named Kareem Abdul-Jabbar that played in a small town where we were going, you know, meeting up or whatever, doing music, going to college. And he played for Western Kentucky University. And so did Fishkill. Yeah, Hilltop of Red. And man, somehow the music got to L.A. to an A&R named Mike Caron. And He wasn't the head of Elektra and Warner yet. And he learned a lot about music through us, and he put together a great roster. I watched him sign T.I. and several acts to make Atlantic an empire.
And when you talk about empire, you all were part of a roster that was just on fire. You know, T.I., of course, a lot of people forget that his
Trick
first
Daddy.
Album, I'm Serious. Yeah, Trick Daddy, Atlantic Slip and Slide, I believe. Correct me if I'm wrong, Trina was on Atlantic too, wasn't she?
Yeah, they were doing their thing
over
there. And
yeah,
I think after I'm Serious, T.I.'s first, you remember that?
That was on Motown.
Yeah,
he did that with the
mm-hmm. Neptunes. No, Beanie Mine. And that was kind of, remember when Nelly had the world in a frenzy? And it was kind of dirty, nobody like that. And then Nappy Roots came in with, hey, we the Midwest. And you just book it and we'll make them buy it. So then we came with that mentality, and Atlantic went and signed that, you get in the road 4 hours away from the house and make it happen shop by shop, nook and cranny. So Nappy Roots at Atlantic Records defined what it took to break good old Southern acts. So
Go ahead.
So learning that process of how to relate to the common man and only doing records that touch the heart, that have meaning. And so that was kind of, we made the way of the blueprint of selling 1 million records this way. And then the guys like Kanye and T.I. were already from big city, metropolitan, so we used those routes to make big waves that way, and then Napster came out, and we got downloaded 11 million times illegally.
Hey, but it shows the popularity. When we think about that era, you had in the late 90s Cash Money, which what everybody considers the bling era. Then, of course, Rockefeller. You know, Rough Riders were part of that
as
well.
No Limit,
then,
No Limit.
Yeah, No Limit. I mean, you're looking at these different elements of hip-hop in terms of style, attitude, fashion. Rockefeller becomes prominent, of course, with the fly, flashy lifestyle. You know, of course, Nas, Mobb Deep are still doing it at the time, so you still have that New York grittiness. There was a lot of different flavors in the game, and you all bought something that was totally different. When did you all realize when the record really began to take off in terms of radio play, when you started doing shows? Take us through that.
Like, we came from a college town.
Okay.
And my mom twisted the back of my dad was a garbage man. So I was out, and I played football, so I was always around a diverse crowd.
Right.
And so doing music to satisfy both ears, being from the west end of town as well as being across the bypass in a small town, if you know how that is. Just the transformation of relating to so many people. Like, instead of saying, like, maybe I'm locked up, they won't let me out. And that's talking to a po folk, right? Well, mm-hmm. me thinking all my life been po, that means locked up, won't let me out. That means these people too. So it was just relating to a lot of people. And to realize that you had that appeal. And then once getting downloaded 11 million times, it was like, wow. And our last album was recorded with Rico Wade and Organized Noise and meeting the whole
Pat cousin. Murray. Ray Murray, Pat Brown, Rico Wade. Yeah.
Yeah, Big Rude.
Organized Noise.
Yeah, Andre 3-Stack, Big Boy Sleeping. You know. And so we worked the last album with them. So in that process, I learned to produce. Enrico Wade kind of freed me in the identification of who I was. He's like, you Lionel Richie of the group. I've been waiting to meet you.
And then, okay. So, I pray.
Leaving Nappy Roots, you know. I'm like Lionel Richie. I took my sound with me. And they live in Atlanta now, so it's kind of different. We hadn't been in the room with each other in 10 years. So you're definitely going to see what I brought to the table more so, and with probably a little more to it.
Now, we talked about the rapping influences. Who are your musical influences in terms of the instruments, in terms of like bands and singers and all of that?
I'm definitely Fleetwood Mac driven. Barry White, Marvin Gaye.
Okay, before you go on, you said Fleetwood Mac. Christie McVie or Stevie Nicks? Who? Which
Stevie.
Iteration of Fleetwood?
Stevie. My favorite song.
Okay.
I listen to Landslide and Dreams a lot. I listen to a lot of Mumford and Sons. Aretha Franklin. I was fortunate enough to meet Richard Pennington when we did the second album in L.A. He explained about rock and roll and his contributions, and I reminded him similar of what I was going through with this country genre of rap that had nobody seen before. And he said they won't know what to do with it until later. He said this is something different. And so go ahead.
Go ahead, please.
So just the second album we shot and was in L.A. for like 9 months straight.
Mm-hmm.
So to really get that culture and to work with Rafael Sadiq and Mike City and, you know, and be around the elements in California from just a country boy in a small town, it was just different. And some great work came out then. And now, oh my, you heard the music?
Man, I mean, the evolution is something extraordinary when you look at, you know, the drive. When you got in and you really found in earnest how this game works and your creative energy was just totally endless, what did you find about yourself in the process of it? How you were able to create your orbit of outstanding in the space of create, and just being able to work with so many people and explore different genres and sounds, and how it all fuses together to make something, you know, phenomenal.
I guess you only listen to a great influence. Once I met Prince, and then, you know, being in Kanye's genius and working with him, and you kind of know where you are.
Mm-hmm.
And to bring a sonically thing that's going to fit, like, more like today, like, if I was to do something like, I'm going to shoot my jumper, meaning I'm going to take my shot. Okay. No matter what, I'm going to shoot my jumper. And if I miss rebound, block out rebound, you know, hustle rebound, just rebound. Like,
right.
I want to put you in an arena mood. I want to put you in an arena mind state. You know, when you hear bars like, my hustle's pretty, like a Girl Scout cookie, Greek freak in the paint, watch what I do to it. You better pledge allegiance and respect my lines. I lock that motherfucking door. You in the room with a lion. And bitch, I ain't lying. And boy, I ain't playing. My will change minds and force a man hand. 420 is the digit to make your mind feel it. Gray hair in my beard. Been at it for a minute. Blind men touch my flow. Only for a feeling. And lean their head sideways. Come just a grinning. I bullshit you out of lane. Get pinned to the ceiling. Get rid of dirty subject like a dose of penicillin. If I'm not Michael Jordan, at least Scottie Pippen. You feel me?
we're just like
straight bars right
like,
there,
man. What do you think about that, Eric?
You feel what I'm talking?
Yeah, and that's a lot of people would say today in the game that's what's missing. But I tell everybody, the bars are still there. You're an example of that. You know, we have people like R.J. Payne, the whole Griselda crew. You know, Cam and China, you know, shout out to the West Coast, G Perico. Hip hop is alive and well. We do have our consternations about what's being played, which we don't think is indicative of the culture. You know, that's, you know, but it's artists like yourself who showed the positive, the ingenuity, the imagination, and the proclamation of what makes the culture great. When you think about that era you all were coming up in with the music, how is it different now than what it was back then in terms of the process of creating all the way even down to how artists are signed?
I think now creative is hard for people who've never played outside. Never made their own games up, so they won't be able to make up their own rhythms much and as long, and it hadn't lived a lot to give you content. Have you ever heard the old saying, a cat won't be fooled by a kitten? What I mean is like, I think we learn things from each other enough that this can go on forever. Like now that the young folks is kind of learning how to new slang and new jargon to say it, or a new way to feel, to for most. But hip hop now is diverse as well as the world, to where FIFA outsells Madden, right? In my day, Madden was the only thing out. Hip hop is driven to where there are thousands of identities of expression. And back then, people made up their own games in their head, and then everybody was different. We didn't know what New York rap sound like till we got there. We didn't know what D.C. sound like till we got there. We didn't know Texas was slow and chopped until we got there, until this internet thing. And everybody had their own thing. Now we can get on the internet and get in each other's world and kind of know where we, you know, trying to do things to relate, where everyday people relate anyway. And, you know, in my time, to where I think it's simpler for us to stay us. And then space age kids that have no feeling, it's simpler for them to be them. It's, you know, they sell more McDonald's than Longhorn, but who tastes better, you know?
When you look at the level of celebrity and you see artists today who rely on a lot of gimmicks and glitchy stuff to try to be relevant, you all did it on real talent and hustle. Where do you see the game today with how a lot of artists are handling being in the spotlight and being exposed in that exposure?
I don't think they realize that it's a tomorrow. Security goes away. God is just. God is fair.
Amen. Amen.
You reap what you sow. Music is a tabloid. And I just think, again, it results back to identity. Gangsters are not Christian. Christian are not this. That, you know what I'm saying? And so forth and so on. So I think you read what you sow. Karma, if you will. They make Mellow Mushroom as well as Little Caesars, you know. Some people don't want a message or a full meal. They'd rather have a bowl of rice with some soft meat on top of it, cooked in about 5 minutes and pull out, right? Shogun Express.
And it's deep to think about, man, because we, you know, you as a distinguished veteran, us as children of the culture, you know, in our 40s, we all understand the culture differently than what the new generation does. And that's not to say that we hate all the music out there. No. But is there some music? Yeah. And that's not to say we hate it. We don't. You know, there's a lot of great talent out there.
Fuck around, drown, trying to find his way. That baby got four different bitches. That nigga fly. I like the aggression of that other nigga. That Memphis shit, I like that too. Like Bobby Smarter. I like shit. And no rats inside my dog out. I pay attention to that. You know, if it bop, we bop it. You know?
Yeah. I think one thing, though, we look at it now, because back in the day, you really had to have a hustle. You really had to get out and get it
in order to get on.
You know, and with the advent of social media, we're seeing where a lot of, like you said, a lot of the youth are getting into it, but they don't necessarily have the requisite experience in life or even a full understanding of the culture at large, you know, to really fully articulate it. They have an idea of what they want to articulate, but the delivery of it and how it is overall, you know, presented becomes problematic. And I think that's where the generation gap comes into play in terms of how people are going to dictate, you know, what it is and isn't. Because the music is all music.
I really don't think it's the people.
I think it's advertising dictated.
That's true.
Yeah, because there's good music that we haven't heard. And we won't hear because people got avenues. And there's gatekeepers in everything. And like I said, there's gatekeepers in everything. And the best that you, now that it's independent, you just make what they like. And then you cut out all the middlemen when you salsa. And somebody's going to play your tune that one day. They make Rollins Records, you know, when they put out Mos Def and all in that movement, as well as NWA. So there's, you know, a diverse people now. That we have enough data on hip hop. She got gray hair now. We can make an adjustment. I think it's going to get better years to come. I think we're figuring it out. Do you?
I think we are. Me and King have talked about this off the air. We've talked about it on the air. You know, of course, he does another show, sensational show with Comet and Black Poets, Screwball Radio, that really breaks into, you know, going into the underground hip-hop scale. I think a lot of times, King and V, I think when we look at where the music is, you all came along at a time where it was not necessarily as corporate-driven in terms of radio. We still had video shows. The magazines were still very influential. I mean, you all made Double XL and Source. I mean, that's huge. I mean, I believe I have a Fez issue y'all were in as well. You know, you all, and the thing is, it was enough room for everybody. Nobody was blocking anybody else from being popular. You know, King and myself, we talk about this all the time about how there was such diversification from roughly when hip-hop first really started breaking in the airwaves in the mid-'80s to 2005, 2007. It was nobody was infringing on anybody. We heard everything, and the level of lyricism was high. But one thing about hip hop, although it's a street culture in the intrinsic sense of where it was birthed, it still allowed for fun. You know,
yeah.
We had, you know, Nelly. We could hear Nelly's song and party in the club. We could hear Jeezy if we wanted to thug it out. We could hear Jay-Z if we wanted to feel fly, you know, fresh and flashy. You know, Cash Money, you know, when you really want to have everybody turn up and dance. You know, 50
yeah.
Cent would come in late. I mean, it was, and now I think where we're seeing, and like you said, V, we're getting back to it, but if for a time, everything became so cookie cutter, such a formula. Everybody in, how do I word this? Because I don't want to, I would never, you know, crush anybody's dreams of art, but I'll say everybody got into rap thinking that they could rap and not everybody could do it.
It was more business and no honesty. It was a lot of participation trophy, these kind of people. I played too. Don't nobody give a damn if you didn't win. You know, so I've been home coaching kids, you know, teaching the matches, you know, and that's what happened. I think to music and life, people wanted notoriety. And they, you know, and you had to live a certain way to be immortal. You have to die a certain way.
And right, right.
Now, you know, they taking pictures at the hospital, fixing their face and shit. Man, hell, everybody want to die without dying. And, you know, to receive the love of that. And everybody's somebody. And now, you know, everybody got a Facebook and a Twitter and a MySpace and a side hustle. And it replaced the value of the rapper, where they wanted to be the rapper so much, they love the rapper so much, wind up being a thin line between love and hate.
But what you said, V, also was very resonating as well about when you said in the hospital, this, that, and the other, like Big said, hauntingly, prophetically, on life after death. You know, you're nobody until somebody kills you.
Yeah.
You know, and
what's
rest in peace.
Yeah.
Man.
Yeah.
I mean, rest in peace to Chris Wallace, man, because he saw that shit way before we really, really understood it. Oh, God. I mean, the genius that man has.
Oh, man. He knew it. And then, like I said, when that was happening, people seen, I think, learn from their mistakes. And those people seen the first deal, like being from Kentucky, that ship only came around one time. But if you from metropolitan New York or metropolitan L.A. or Chicago or Atlanta, there's deals that happen around the corner. And so you mess up two or three of them, like Puffy or the rest of them, you know, and then they learn by experience what to do. What's going to happen, and putting songs in people. We didn't learn that until the people that had been through what we've been through came around. You know, and everybody was around to pick your bones up. Oh, I would do it this way, you know, and they had experience at it. So now I think people are now talking and sharing things that we never would have known without these podcasts.
And I think that's always been, you know, let's think about it today. Go ahead.
Y'all was saying the pandemic, I think the podcasting, in a way, it opened up great avenues for people to get in the new lane and find their voice, which was the original concept. But now it opened up a Pandora's box of buffoonery in a lot of ways.
Everybody want to be heard, huh?
Yeah.
Every way, shape,
know,
or form.
Yeah, everybody telling their experiences, from ball players to athletes, and making your goals a little different now. You remember when you go to the carnival and fair, you would go to see the 75-pound rabbit or the lady with a beard and three tits, or the 8-foot man. You know, you had to be a freak to be in the carnival.
Right.
Where they let normal people in the carnival, they're talking about the freak. You see what I'm saying?
Yes, ma'am.
Like anybody with natural talent wasn't really a person, right? It wasn't natural everyday that. They was gifted with a gift. But now they let people in that don't have a gift.
And one thing about it with solitary is people want, like you said, everybody wants to be heard, but not everybody has something worth hearing. I know that may sound harsh to some, but the fact is...
I think you're breaking up a little bit.
Can you hear me?
Okay, you sound a little muffled.
Not really. Yeah, sorry, somebody got a child over your mouth.
Oh, Lord. No, I'm all right. Can y'all hear me?
Yeah, you good.
All right, they ain't got it tied up, y'all. They ain't got it tied up.
I'm safe. Can y'all hear me?
Make sure them ninjas don't get my brother, man.
Yes, sir.
Can y'all hear me now?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Okay. Sorry. Yeah. Yeah, like I was saying, you know, a lot of people want to be heard, but a lot of people don't have much that they're really saying. Like I said, I know that sounds kind of harsh, but it's important when you're in a public space where people can hear you, where you're broadcast, it's of the utmost imperative that you're giving something of jewels that people really can take and treasure from it. Whether you're an MC or whether you're, you know, a journalist, you know, people, like you said, everybody's gotten into a lane now thinking that podcasting and rapping is easy, and it's not, because both are disciplines where you have to understand what makes it work. If you're rhyming, you have to understand bar structure. You have to understand, you know, how your rhymes flow over certain beats. You have to understand how to create songs. If you're podcasting, you have to know information. History is a must. How to communicate with people. You know, what type of conversations do you want to bring? You know, are you monolithic or are you multicultural, being able to talk from many different places to many people? It's a matter of giving respect to it. I think more than anything, though, it goes back to how, like you said earlier, about the disclosure of life. Back in the day, being an artist, as you all were, there was not a lot to be known outside of maybe interviews, magazine write-ups, you know, and videos. But the private life of what, you know, an artist did was pretty much routed in seclusion. It was very, even in a sense, clandestine. You know, nobody really knew about you in terms of what they only knew what you wanted them to know. And now everybody is so, everybody is so bent on trying to give up the most valuable currency of their existence, which is privacy, which they will put on sale to gain profit to put in their pocket. When you got into the game in terms of music, how important was it for you all to maintain a certain sense of normalcy, especially, you know, coming from Kentucky and really putting on for your city, for your state, understanding what you all wanted to represent, and when the fame started to come, how you all managed to deal with it as individuals, not getting overwhelmed by it?
I think we hate each other more so to keep each other grounded. And you're never gonna. I guess it was the gift and the curse, because we watched each other grow. And we all knew when the last time you wasn't that confident. And this time, you know, we really check each other. And we never got outside of, you know, bigger than life. We always felt small sitting by the ocean and realized life is seasons. It was just our turn to, you know, it was harvest that time. And running into guys like Andre O'Reilly and guys that were lifelong, you know, Uptown Records and this and people who've seen things. He's like, y'all got here on your first try. I was like, what you mean first try? And there's like, it don't happen, Z. It was like, not your first album, nobody knows you. And I was like, what? He was like, 1 million copies on your first album? Was you lucky or good? And then I was telling him nobody wrote the record but me and us. You know, we wrote out, you know, we was doing it. And he was like, wow, y'all going to be here a while.
Mm.
And then to watch how things went and the people we met. And to watch it, like I said, we learned a lot of things in the middle of hip-hop forming, Southern hip-hop forming. And we did stay grounded. And none of us ever put out a solo record because we all needed each other to thrive. They introduced us as Nappy Roots and not Big B or Skinny or Prophet like they did Nelly or the St. Lunatics. You see, the other way around.
And not to throw shade, first off, rest in peace to Andre Harrell. That man's genius. The visionary, the just understanding how this thing really worked. He's one of the all-time great executives, you know, along with Russell Simmons, you know, Shakir Stewart, rest in peace. So, you know, Ted Lucas of Slip and Slide. I mean, just so many, but however many you want to name in terms of music executives in the industry. Of course, Damian Young as well. Shout out to him. Power 106 in L.A. Andre is one of the guys who really blazed that trail for the modern generation. I mean, you know, even with Puffy, you know, for all the things that have been going on with Puff, one thing can be said. Puff's gotten results over the years, and we will not ever.
He's a great at what he does.
Yeah.
He's a great at what he does.
But not to throw shade, what you were saying earlier, V, about how you all were introduced as a group and what you were saying about Nelly and St. Lunatics, you look at the situation that's going on that's happened the past couple of years with a lot of those guys from Nelly's crew and how they've kind of been going at each other about stuff. You know what I'm saying? And it's like, you know, you all were one of the biggest groups of the time, you know, but now, you know, there's all this stuff about who wrote who and such and such may have not gotten everything they were due. And I'm like, this ain't the way to handle this publicly.
No, you don't want to blow the money. You know, what can be salvaged. But in every instance, man, it's always going to be an Easy from NWA or Muddy Waters from Cadillac Records. I think I played both roles. But in the end, I pulled up Muddy Waters and walk away to Howlin' Wolf. You know, I don't borrow from the store. Just pay what you owe me. And, you know, and I walked away like that and creating a QR code where you scan with your phone and get the music and put the QR code on cannabis products and to know 11 million people and to now only tour in legal states of cannabis. And to sell your album at $100 a half instead of wearing about 40-cent scan is what I adjusted and did.
So that's a perfect segue into the next topic in terms of you evolving in terms of other avenues of your enormous talent. Because we got to do this in sequential order because, of course, the weed legalization came later.
But
acting has always been legal. So let's break into how you began to evolve and exercise your tremendous thespian talent. Tell us about that.
Acting. I always came from a house of entertainment. Rather, it was my stepfather acting like his boss or my mother going to church and singing and praying and interacting with others. And it was always entertainment. And, you know, being a kid that grew up in the 80s, born in the 70s, watched a lot of TV. and Fred Sanford and Red Fox, you know, Bernie Mac and Bruce and Archie Bunker and all Sidney Poitier and all the greats, you know, and I was always a big fan of Morgan Freeman as well as Denzel Washington. But Morgan Freeman, I ran into him on Reading Rainbow and the Junction, Once You Function, you know, back in going to school. And I was in drama and theater in high school. I was a small engines guy. So I always had this idea of why, when I watched Bobby Jones, I always wanted to do my thing as a kid. And, you know, I lived several lives, and the cat got 9 lives, and if you like it, you share one with him. So a lot of people thought I had talent. So we started going to movie sets or whatever. Jamie McCoy gave me a shot or two, and she was managing Pastor Troy and a bunch of acts over Universal. She started getting into films and wanted me to do my thing a long time ago. But God in this time clock ain't everybody else's. So got into movies and did 4 over the last 3 years. Started my last one, 45 Seconds. Pretty good. And what a great cast of artists. I mean, actors. So now I'm writing movies and stuff to get my Craig Ice Cube on, you know.
What type of freedom has that been able to afford you in terms of being able, I won't say afford because I feel like that doesn't give justice. What type of freedom does that outlet give you in terms of the freedom to really create a canvas of not only art to be translated into film, but being a black man in America, how you present that vision to the world at large?
Through a working class lens, like if you watch movies like Sling Blade, I come from rural America.
Oh my God. Yo.
I come from rural America like that. You know, I'm staring down at Bill Cox's outfit, and, you know, the intelligence level in Kentucky, look it up. And you see a lot of walks of life here. A lot of people starting off, starting over, starting for, you know, and I come from working class. So you get that down home, everybody know you, people care kind of thing. And then Nashville, 60 miles away. And you get that city vibe of don't nobody give a damn. And then north is Louisville, home of the first 48, if you watch that kind of TV. There's a lot of walks of life that you get to walk here. And to be able to write about them and dictate them and show you in a working boy's lens, you know, of childhood traumas and getting those out. And to show you if mama woulda, if daddy coulda, that might have changed your identity. But still and yet, God give you life. Enjoy all things, not all things to enjoy life. And that's what my pen and my vision is showing, the circle of life, the journey of a black man, most of us raised by a woman, where your stripes came later.
When you look at our current social climate today, in terms of where we're seeing, seemingly, we can't say, how do I want to word this? We've always had issues in terms of, you know, what's befell black people in terms of socioeconomic deprivation, disadvantages, racism, a lack of knowledge and outlet. Today, it seems to be a little more pronounced at times. When you look at our current condition as a people, how we interact with each other, how we understand things, how we take in information, what are your observations on what's going on today?
I think more now than ever, we have an ear and more data. And we're living in a time that we're more aware of absolutely course of action and dealing with men raised by women and dealing with men raised by men and getting on the same page and learning how to catch up with maybe changing the flat tire or concern of the pack, you know, and not being selfish. And you're seeing more fathers raising the household. I was a single custodial parent, and cats in my small town now seeing my strength and jumping some of the hurdles that they were afraid to jump 10 years ago before I left the music scene and realizing a man with no future is going to die silent.
Oh, my God. Ooh, that part.
So, you know, I think now that the internet and movies and short films are coming out on Tubi and you seeing real people with real pens and real life traumas screaming help. And now to be one of those voices to teach them to say fire instead of help. And you know, and just watching as everything evolves, we getting sharper. We learning what to do with our 70 years.
That's powerful. From that, you all, you know, in the music scene also as well, you know, you all came at a time where it really was about the fun and the creativity.
Yeah.
Obviously, you all were, as I said earlier, you all were the country cousins that everybody loved. So you all really brought a lot of warmth and a lot of soul. You made everybody feel good every time they listened to your music. It was uplifting. It was pragmatic, positive, and most importantly, it came from a sincere place of wanting the best for the world and the people that lived in it.
Yes, sir.
So obviously, beef was never something y'all got into in terms of, you know, having issues with other artists.
No.
We're seeing a culture now, King and V, where a lot of these artists are openly not only embracing it, but they're asking for it.
I think they don't have content. And, you know, you're a lot of calls if you ain't flavor. You know, if you're a cook, you know. A lot of people make up, you know, once they get weak in the hips, they go with the lip. Have you heard that? So a lot of people don't live enough content to give you content. So they had to make up shit to keep you interested instead of the music.
Everything is based off content now.
Yeah.
Content is everything moving more than the music, sadly.
Yeah, content. Everybody wants to interact and figure out you human after all. And you ain't no better than me. Well, cool, but here's a song. And here's some weed. Are you doing the best you? You know, what's that about? What's your favorite color? Your favorite song? What weather could you do without? Do your kids know you? And why? Why not? And then I think my music addressed all that, where everybody's got their thing to say, but you take a kid when we were kids, all we wanted was a rental car, a spring break, you know, a shallow pool, right?
Yeah, yeah.
I don't think they're outlandish. I just think they ran out of things to say. And we clap for the wrong damn thing. You know, we clap for that shit. If you don't pay it no attention, that y'all won't do it.
And that's always that an element. Go ahead.
If that don't get nobody's attention, hey, man, I'm fucking up. Show him my ass. You can't come in here. Put them guns up. What the hell you acting tough for? What are you hiding? You some sad son of a bitch? Look at you. What are you crying for? What are you mad for? Is there something we need to know? You know. I don't want to party with your weird ass. What you got that gun like that for? Get the fuck away from me. You know, you ain't talk to them weird son of a bitches like that. You know, you have to address the silly son of a bitch in that manner and let him know it ain't cool.
But, you know, I think that's where we've seen a shift, because there are elements of the game where back in the day it really meant something that you stood on business representing something that was true, that was not outlandish. Even if it was a little, you know, different. I can't even say, well, rest in peace to the late, great MF Doom, one of my favorite MCs of all time. Doom had something that was different, but Doom was a dope MC, and Doom, that was just who he was when you really understood the story of how he adopted it from KMD and Zev Love X to MF Doom. That's a whole other subject. But the genius of what he embodied in the culture of hip-hop, Doom is one of my favorite rappers ever, just for his originality alone. But he still fit within that space. You know, and you still, but, you know, and when you see a lot of these rappers today, they just get out there, like you said, you know, they just, I mean, we see everything from dudes wearing dresses and purses to calling other men feminine names as a term of endearment. And it's just like, it's just something that we didn't come up seeing. We don't. Go ahead.
Our parents, I think, got us for a world that wasn't there anymore. Like, these kids got to understand it's self-esteem, but a lot of them raised by girls, so they think like girls. And you know how a girl come up playing, watch out, bitch, you know, ugly motherfucker, where black dude don't play that shit. My name's Sonny. What's your name, Darryl? And we address each other that way. How you doing, brother? It's good to see you. And what's the move, man? You know, we talk about what we're going to get done, raised by men, you know, really cool to get the concept. With the fuckery. We don't horseplay. You know, we don't ride in each other's cars. I'll meet you there. If you ride my car, you're going to want to fuck with my radio. And no, that can't happen. And you know, when
still applies.
Yeah, I mean, just anybody, when you're going to want yours. Any man's going to want his son to have his own car at 16, and can't nobody ride in there.
I'm grooming you.
You know, and we've gotten away from that, where a woman, a bar ride, they think they're making it through life. Where men, most times, don't beg or borrow. He got his own. Where, you know, a woman will catch a ride, and that's cool. And most times, when you come from single-parent homes, you in the house with a woman. So you think like a woman. You look in the mirror and get dressed, you know, and look at your ass with like a woman, right? And then she's dressing you like somebody who broke her heart. I fucked over her. So y'all going to get into arguments. And before you know it, you got the world on your shoulder disrespecting your father. Don't realize you look just like him. And she teaching you how to disrespect him and don't tell him. And that's bled over to the music.
Man, yo. But see, the way you put that, because some people would take offense to it, but I tell people, there are going to be people who echo the same sentiment as you, V, but I don't think anybody could deliver it as well as you just did, in terms of it from being a calm, conversational, and matter of fact type of template. Because when you look at certain elements, and this is not to, you know, try to, because some will hear this conversation, try to say, well, you know, they're trying to trample on gay black men or, you know, feminine. No, we're not doing that at all, because everybody has a right to live their truth no matter what. But
don't give a damn if you eat our apples or oranges. Yeah, it's your diet. Yeah, but, you know, I ain't calling it that. I just know where
right,
it's at.
But you're speaking from how things, right, and how these, how life experiences of what you were raised in and what you observe, how they begin to, how you begin to absorb it and ultimately how you present that from what, you know, because people are only going to act in a fashion of what they know in their media environment.
Yeah.
And if you come from a good environment, you become a good product. If you come from a negligent product, you know, a negligent environment, you become a product that could possibly go in the wrong direction. Yeah.
Yeah, hell yeah. You know. You know how it go. The working man, working class, his daddy gets overlooked. They don't like him in the house.
Yeah.
He's a good
guy. You know, it's crazy because when Chris Rock said it, and shout out to him, shout out to Rashidi Harper, who did the incredible headliners film with him and Kevin Hart. You know, Chris Tucker, I mean, he nailed this shit when he said it. And he said, the man is only loved. And I think he meant just in general with men. He's like, the man is only loved by what he is able to provide. And so, you know,
not
for black
men. Not even that. Like, if you work out on the road, like, say, a truck driver or an artist, you the one going to get fucked over. You ain't never home. So they ain't never going to deal with you. You're an extensive hand, and you could be paying all the bills.
Right.
And she give it to him. You know, don't tell your daddy. You know how a woman is. And then we can ignore it. But we, you know, most cats act like just like their mama. They can't help it. They've been raised by a girl. Or either their grandmother raised them. So they act more like Tyler Perry than Roy Jones, you know. Nothing bad on Tyler Perry. It's just, if you're raised by an older woman, you would act more Medea's, more in the church play, more in the, we see all the walks of life, and I'm not pointing out to anybody. I don't give a damn if you not a church goer. It make me no difference. But I'm just saying, everybody, if you round crocodiles, you're going to act like a damn crocodile.
That's facts.
Yeah, I don't, you know. There's a lot of people dealing with a lot of traumas, and that's why I came up with my dispensary. I come from addiction capital of the world, the meth lab capital of the world, the human trafficking capital of the world.
Go ahead.
What was what?
I was going to ask, when did you get the idea? What was the impetus of it in terms of when you were where, you know, it was a recreational thing for you, but then you realized this really could be something to benefit people?
Being an artist in the early 90s, 2000, then when you couldn't smoke reefer the way you wanted to, you go to jail.
Right.
And then they had other drugs in Hollywood, like powder or molly or MMDA. And that was my drug of choice. And then once you're in a circle doing hard drugs, you're around a bunch of people that's probably been abused and running from something that they don't want to be or they can't be right now.
Right?
So, and then they do the hard drugs and wind up doing the shit that hurt them anyway.
Right.
So then I got to being in these circles and far away from my friends. And when you using hard drugs, you around everybody that ain't your friend. And you learn their world and what and why they in it. So then I was like, so if you gonna do the drugs and do the shit that hurts you, why not say fuck doing drugs and keep your money and just learn the trauma and what put you there and the triggers. So then I became more of a healer, and I became more of a philanthropist into this thing I call finding your you, meaning you going through things. The butterfly was once a caterpillar.
Gotcha.
So being in those hard circles and having counseling with these cats that do drugs and still have sex with somebody like they pedophile that done them that way, or you know, and it's just, oh, that's why you're doing the hard drugs. Yeah, because they can't deal with being a vampire. In the movies, you know, the vampire catch that cat out of the store and bite the neck and the bags fly, and an hour and a half later, the victim's in an asylum and Dracula dies and the land goes back the same. Well, in real life, Dracula's at your grandmother's house. You see what I'm saying? It don't go away. But they wind up doing hard drugs and becoming a statistic. So that's why I promote healing and mental health as a black man. Your mother probably don't like you as a black man. You look like somebody who hurt her. And you never measured up to that guy that's preaching about God, so you ain't one of them. And if you got anything, you probably hustled for it in a different way than anybody taught you all to have it. So it's just different, man. That's why we write music and drink Jack Daniels.
When we look at the state of black America, because this is a conversation that is not talked about but is essential in a discussion because it's such a pertinent subject, how important is it for black people to address these issues in terms of upraising, in terms of how we treat our children, how we talk to them? Because a lot of things, I'm going to be real with it. I know this is going to be controversial saying it. Some of the things are toxic traits in terms of, you know, what goes on in the black household in terms of the kids not being allowed to really say how they feel about something, or even over physical abuse. To me, some of that really is an extension of the slave plantation. How do we get away from that?
Education. People
got to get
education. And while you educate the kids, you got to educate the parents. And the parents got to be willing to admit their shortcomings and willing to, like, damn, that was internal. But now I know better, I can do better. I'll choose better.
Right.
So I just think when you set out to have a kid with somebody, you don't know who that son of a bitch is at 17 through 23.
That's true.
And then... And then, you know, y'all might not have the same interest in life. Just that night in the bars, they looked like the way you wanted to look, and you went different, right? And then y'all trying to determine which way this kid's going to go and wind up, yeah, putting oil in the water.
Yeah. And I think but there's so many layers, Z, to that conversation because, like you said, you know, it goes into the whole thing about a lot of black women talk about how black men ain't shit, you know, and then the black men having ill feelings towards black women. I don't want to oversimplify it, saying it. And please, you know, we definitely want to get your opinion on it. Go ahead, King. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to say, man, I think people need to find therapy. And when you find therapy, you get to see your flaws, you get to see your pros and cons of what you need to work on. The problem is people are so ego, you know, caught up in the ego and their pride, they don't want to admit they have a problem.
No, nonsense, so to speak. People switch people so they don't have to change.
Man, that's a gem right there. You know, because
yeah,
the thing is, and I think when people have to look at that character mirror and understand that it ain't no amount of Windex going to wipe them cracks out of it, you know, you have to be honest, you know, with yourself. And that's a level of candor a lot of people are not willing to have a conversation with themselves about, because you have to understand, I think a lot of people have to understand, you know, that if you're having dealings with people and it's always some type of element where they have a falling out with you, it's not everybody. It's you that they're having falling outs with, and there's a reason for that, you know, whether relationships, business, whatever. And people have to understand, at the end of the day, you have to be the person that when you look in the mirror, when you appraise yourself, that you can applaud yourself for who you're being rather than be covered with the tomatoes thrown at you from your own bad dealings.
Well, a lot of people can't get out of their own way because they don't know those. They know a way. And people aren't that different. If you go to look at blue jeans, they ain't but four cuts. If you go get condoms, they ain't but four cuts. Lifestyle, XL, and everybody else is average. Lambskins, I think, over there, you know, on the most part, people ain't that different. There's only five brand of cars, right? Volvo, Toyota, Ford, Chrysler. Something, right? Ain't that different.
Yep.
Cadillac. You know, I just saying, time and people aren't that different. And if it's easier to be wrong, then why even be right? Takes more effort for a clock to tick than just stop.
Oh man, and the thing is, either way, whether the clock tick or it don't, the time still moves. It's just about are you gonna make the move, or you know, are you still gonna be, you know, dedicated to making the most of that time. That's
oh man,
that's deep.
I'm telling you, in a twinkle of an eye, it's over. And if you ever seen a funeral home and that cop pull out in the middle of the road, ready to let that family out to go bury their loved one, you'll see it every hand. If anybody can take a right or get the hell away from that line, they're gone. That's how much time people care about your life, right?
Yeah.
Facts.
So when you're doing what you're doing and you ain't going hard because of somebody else's opinion, you might want to go to that funeral parlor and see how much time anybody got for your life. People that really love you cry about a week, about a month. They putting your pictures and going through your good phone and dividing your shit, and then what they don't want of yours, they take it somewhere and dump it. So yes, that's what goes for anybody who built five cars and got $200,000 or $300,000they plan to walk out of here with. You saving up for a younger man.
Man, that's, you know, as they say, you can't take it with you. You know what I'm saying?
So you leave your legacy and plan it all the way out. Leave nothing chance.
Yeah,
and that's
man.
The most important thing. Yeah, that's the most important thing. When you think about what you have impacted in terms of your legacy, your talent, your gifts, what are you most proud of in terms of your achievements beyond being an artist?
Not disappointing my mom. not letting her sacrifice go in vain by taking somebody's life and putting it behind bars. I'll put myself in a position where someone takes my life and fucking up her work. I'm proud of having kids that's not dead or in jail. They're doing positive things. I'm proud to just be something different. To be the kid that when people talk to my mother, the one he talks about, to be the Michael Jackson of the Jackson 5. To be the superstar of my group and be well within my humble right to say so. To be XXL top 10 rap voice of all time. To be from Kentucky and actually put Kentucky different than it was before I got here. And still be able to play my music in front of pastors and great crowds and not cringe your face and know I'm telling the absolute truth. I mean, other than that, I'm still living a dream. I know things can happen when you pray.
And that's
testimony
something that
is the truth,
yeah,
right there, for real.
Yeah. Yep. I think that's something that I think we can all look back and think about from that perspective of how we, I think the most, Nipsey, the late great Nipsey Hussle said, the greatest act of, you know, being is being a, of a human being is being able to inspire. The marathon of life is a race that we keep running in until, you know, our finish line is when our legs don't move anymore. But we want to make the most of it before we finish. When you think about how you've been able to do all of these different things, you know, especially, I mean, doing commercials as well. I mean, what has that been like, you know, to really be able to, you know, because so many artists, they may be able to do one thing. They might be able to do a couple things, but the time runs out for them and yours is still running in abundance. How does that feel to still be able to not only be active, but to excel in those activities?
I think each situation gives you a moment to be whatever you've been called to be. Like, we didn't know Magic could play center until Kareem got hurt. So, you know, it's call and respond. For me, an ultimate goal was mine to be able to ride 30 miles and listen to my art. You know how some artists got two songs and you got to change the shit. To be one of those artists like Sam Cooke, where I could go into towns and listen to your music and know where you don't have to say my last name, where Vito and where I'm from. It is as common as Budweiser beer here when you said music in my state. And my name come up first. And the life between the deaths. King of barbecue music. Wow. I could only hope.
That's dope, man. It's like you focus it on legacy, because legacy is what mainly makes your name remain relevancy. Like, you know, people can make a whole bunch of money, but if a legacy is tainted, it's not going to mean a hill of beans.
Nah, we want to push more. We want to go over to the Waffle House on the down over there, that jukebox. You know where the greats make it. And then push play. And how does it feel when you eat an hash brown plate with a nice sandwich? Setting somebody next to your love, what will they play? Will they ever play your music as an artist?
Mm-hmm.
I think. I mean, that was a goal of mine, you know, growing up to Michael Jackson, Paul McCartney, Neil Diamond, Otis Redding, Al Green, your Snoop Dogg, Dr. Dre. Oh, man, I've been blessed to hear Adele and Sidney Lauper and Tina Turner, Mike, you know, Prince Nelson.
And that's something to where that type of eclectic musical taste is what fuels genius, because genius, inspiration can come from anywhere. Genius is innate, and most importantly, when properly cultivated and honed, everybody gets to see how great it is. Because once you, you know, what you're exposed to in the most in the best ways of it is going to give it its best motivation, because you understand what you have, and you sometimes, you know, you just don't know what it is, but you know it's something that the world needs to see. And if, you know, if you're blessed enough, you're able to do it, and you're living proof of that.
Life's going life, though.
Yeah.
What's an average day like? Man, I get up at 4:30, stretch, say my prayers. I'm at the gym at 6. 7:30, I'm in my dispensary. I got a morning crowd just getting off work, and they kind of rush. I fill a bunch of mushroom coffee to get a focus in the dynamic view. I do 3 meetings by 10:30, give my staff the word and the go. And then I correlate the music, or I do this thing called Breathe, Light a Chance, where we work on finding your you, and meaning identity. Who are you? And I do that with kids. And then I come back to work about 5 o'clock and work this shift out, man, and steal people one flower or cannabis product at a time. For the last 11 years, my son plays with, well, I got a son that plays for Deion Sanders right now. That's a
shout out to Colorado.
Player. Yeah, he did. 2 years at Kentucky, we went 10-2 in the SEC. Won 2 bowl games. Our first team All-American, class of 2020. I got a daughter that plays basketball at college. I got a school teacher son that's a football coach, just won the state title again.
Okay.
I got truck drivers and pretty good people. 2 of my girls own restaurants. Run restaurants for good owners, and I got a host of grandkids. So I'm Big Daddy. They watch me go from Ice Cube to Calvin. Yeah,
and that's okay. That is that. I mean, that's called legacy. That's called longevity. That's called good dad gang.
Yeah.
When you think about that element also too, because obviously the game was good for you in terms of the finances, what did you learn the most at that time about how to take care of your money? And, you know, when
finances,
you were ready
to... never got my crack at it as far as
mm-hmm.
the rap game. I got mm-hmm. the motivation. I sniffed the money, a few advances here and there. But
mm-hmm.
I just now started getting paid from Good Day in 2017.
Oh, wow.
You know, if you watch NWA, sort of
mm-hmm.
like, you know, Easy and I was more Ice Cube, Dr. Dre, took me a long lesson, you know, before I got it together. And
understood.
Then, you
understood.
Know, I've been through several forms of Kentucky and L.A. or Kentucky and New York. So ain't nobody never played fair with me as a businessman. So I took my challenge elsewhere and went home and created this QR code. And I know 11 million people. And the computers made the world real small. And so I feel like Dr. Dre, when you talk about watching it come and watching it go, I've switched 3 or 4 times. But I got one rule. I, I'll give out 20 times before I ever get in. And I've always worked for myself. So rather the music was doing that, I've always been a cannabis man, you know.
And you found your lane. What does that mean to you to be able to be an entrepreneur? And most importantly, because some people who have the dealings that are not the best in the game, they tend to be bitter and angry about it. You're neither. You know, you're yeah. motivated, you're philosophical, inspirational.
Definitely.
And most importantly, you still, you know, have the drive to keep doing it. How are you able
to be
free? How are you able? Yeah. Mm-hmm, to be free. Yeah.
Free. After I met Prince, Lil Richie, Rick James, I realized it ends a certain way, and it's all in. Like I told you, seasons. Some seasons I was meant to harvest. Some meant to sow seeds. Some meant to cheer for others while they win. And I could feel like a whole lot of people that didn't feel like they got their shake, but I feel like the world heard me. Atlanta done right by promoting my records. And we were creating something. What I done 20 years ago got us on the phone right now. And then having a listening party on Friday in Atlanta, Georgia, 25 years after Watermelon Chicken and Grits came out. We talking 20 years and counting. Hip-hop's 50 years old. She has gray hair and she understands now. And it's like... And it's like people that want that reality rap. It's like buying Pine Sol or Tide or Game, or when they take the McRib away and bring it back. It's time for that. So to be totally well in my identification and totally comfortable with being the way that God makes it. He's right. He's in control. So for me to not submit would totally be probably drive a sane man crazy, you know. So I realize mm-hmm. he's in control. I live some good days and some probably not so good for others, but it didn't take money to make my world. And, you know, and it sure won't make me. And I live comfortable, you know. I don't borrow money or nothing like that. I don't have a chauffeur. But where I'm from, you know, I get a Sunbeam beard, then a cut poach out, hot sauce. I ride in a Hummer. I smoke what I want. You know what I mean?
That's
you know
dope,
what I mean?
Man.
You know.
And that's
all kids
blessing.
Grown. Yeah. And about
that's
health. Health. I ain't sick. I walked away from group in and drugging without AIDS or herpes or none of that shit. Cancer, none of that. Oh, feel like I won the lottery. You know?
You know, and that's special because we see so many, and it's not just hip-hop music. It's about just being in the celebrity life in general, no matter who you are. You know, and we've seen so many celebrities crash out from the excesses of too much. You know, they become addicted to the lifestyle and, you
right.
know, King has hung around celebrities. I've hung around a lot, been to parties, and it's cool in terms of if you really understand, where your limitations are, but you know, we're just regular dudes who just been blessed to be around a lot of famous people. But I can't imagine what it's like to be a famous person and living that life all the time. I mean, where literally everything's available to you, and the thing is, are you going to take everything that's presented to you because it's there?
I mean, you know, when you was a young cat, you probably chased more cars than you chased when you're older. You know,
Oh, yeah, man. It's,
you know,
priorities got to be set first and foremost.
Yeah. You know, you always want somebody to be attracted to you, or you be attracted to somebody. But then what? After that hour or whatever, what's the next three going to be like? Who she got to lie to do this? Or whatever. You know, what this going to hurt? Somebody loves somebody in every town. Yeah, how that goes. And I don't know. A lot of you some choices out there. And it's just about prioritizing things, I guess.
It is. For any artists coming into the game today, what would you tell them in terms of understanding the business aspects and how to and how to do things in moderation?
I would tell them, you signing up for the most dangerous job in North America. On average, the career is shorter than a professional running back.
Hmm. Great sports analogy.
I would say, change this around. Could you cheer for your girl if she signed with the new hottest thing, Nicki Minaj, out there? They gave her $400,000 and he cut a check and left you home with the kids and put them on the bus and calls when she wants to and cut off the location. And she got access to everything. Could you cheer for her?
Hmm.
Would that be out of the question? But you putting strain on a relationship for something you want to do. And everybody with their hands up ain't cheering for you. And I would say this is totally freedom. If you know what you come for and you relate to a certain crowd and they support you, but y'all don't buy music, so what will you sell?
Hmm.
And you remember we said you reap what you sow. But if you ain't bought no music, then you expect anybody else to.
Hmm. And that's, I mean, and that's something that you said, B, is that's another jewel. Because everybody gets into this game thinking that they're going to be the biggest artist out there. Everybody thinks that they're going to... we've been blessed to do this show for a long time.
Yeah.
We talk to people off air. We talk to people off air. You know, we talk to executives. We've talked to rappers. A lot of them are our friends. You know, we've had private conversations with each other and everybody. And we always talk about how everybody thinks that this shit is, you know, easy, you know, and it's like it's not, you know.
Not at all.
You know, everybody thinks that they're going to be the biggest rapper in the world, you know, and they're going to, like you said, the football analogy was brilliant because, you know, if there are only 1,696 players that make it into the NFL roster across 32 teams, mm-hmm. there's twice that many rappers out there across the continental 50 states of this country trying to get on.
Yeah.
And then less than roughly about 0.8% are actually going to become major in terms of
right.
you know getting a hit song, getting an album out, and really really begin the process. You know, and it's not to throw shit on somebody's aspirations, but it takes more than now. Depending on where you're from, it can be. It's definitely helpful. If you're from Atlanta, L.A., New York, you know, Houston, where there's a big entertainment infrastructure, Miami,
you know, you yeah. you got a pretty good head start, you know. But if you're
yeah.
not from any of those places, it's going to be a bit hard to get out there. You know, no matter how dope you think you are, your hood may not be able to push you through, and you're going to need somebody's help to get you out of there.
Yeah. And then how big do you think you want to be? Like for me,
mm-hmm.
we talk L.A., New York, that's cool, but I sold a million records from the country.
Right.
Real bias. So for me, I wouldn't want to necessarily be in L.A. Marga. I could do TV, make me a little hotter, I guess, or somebody's podcast to really bullshit you. But in actuality, I would rather just sell you a great product. In a where there's no stars, where there's nothing but buyers.
Mm.
So if, now that's what I was like. Now, and you could put that on Chicago and all, but for me, I got good cannabis, and a center cut pork chop, and I know the value of that. So I'd rather
right.
put a QR code on that, and then $20 from 5,000 people is 100 racks. Now, how could I repeat that in several cities
right.
across my region? And to me, that's called country platinum. And then good word of mouth grow. You remember how UGK did 900 pieces, 900,000 copies of Riding Dirty without no video or no airplay?
Right.
I'm more of that kind of guy where everybody, you know, listen to that and smoke to it, and you probably don't even know it's out there standing next to you. So now we're trying to bridge the gap to where music makes sense to do it like this. So what, as again I said, as a young artist, what will you sell? They ain't buying music, and then you go talking about guns and bullshit, I'm leaving. Now what are you going to sell? What
mm-hmm.
experience will I get? Yeah. Like if V-Nims and cannabis, and this one does this and this one does that, what will I sell if they ain't bringing, but they ain't buying music?
Yeah.
So
when
as
you
a young
talk,
artist,
mm-hmm.
go ahead.
Mm-hmm.
Who we relate to?
When did you realize with the cannabis thing, when did you know that you really had something in terms of when it really began to pop for you?
About 4 years ago when the country went flat, when COVID hit,
mm-hmm.
and then nothing mattered but peace. And then people loved my music, but they wouldn't buy it. But they loved
right.
listening to it when they smoked. So I was like, here, the QR code, here's the music, and I don't have to print up CDs. No, put it on this bag where no smell, no scent. And this is like tagging dolphins, you know, and the strands to come. You know, hey, Ray, I know your club got gambling. It was like Ray's Boom Boom Room. And then it just became a reality. You know, it was just like that. And just was like, okay, well, I know 11 million people. Between the downloads and wherever Good Day is played on all the good movies and shit, you know, and we still do our own sync license and publishing and shit like that. So I was like, well, how could I? You remember that commercial? I like to buy the world a coke and keep it
yeah.
company. So I like to sell the world a bag and hook up with dispensaries and help them push their product where a great product like that, okay, we smoke this here. Well, then, what's the number one product besides gas and groceries? Rare loaves. Well, what goes in them? So then I got to start, you know, you doing the research on that. And then you just got to, you know, they stop doing commercials. I ain't never seen a commercial for Rolls Royce. So the best dro in the heaven where the best people can get it. And it's sort of like that, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So about 4 years, man, I've been really just attaching my brand to other cannabis brands. And people always relate my music and my brand with good times and big fun and pool parties and swimming pool music and Life by the Beach and Girls Gone Wild and shit like that, as well as Good Thankful People and Tailgater, you know, all that shit. And so that's what I did.
That's what it is, man. You got to make that transformation. That's what branding is all about, basically, is making that transformation from one to another, because you got to evolve, especially with the way how businesses is being paced. One could be easy to shut down. You got to have other avenues open.
Yeah. And you know, chronic going to sell. Whatever. They're going to get high for something. I know I do, right?
right.
And to pay for it, convenience, you know. So let me convenience you with the better smoke and the better, you know. You don't smoke, let me get you a gummy or some oil or something. We figure it out. I got something to fit you. And that's what, you know, that's what it is, branding, man, and relation. Branding in relation.
That's what it is.
Man.
Oh, man, we almost got to wrap this thing up, man, because we almost got about 5 more minutes. Let people know where they can find you and tell us your social media handles and
I'm Vito Bango, world famous Nappy Roots, Big V. You find me on theshit.com. I'm talking shit. Now you can find me. I'm going to be touring everywhere, man. I'll be in Atlanta at a listening party Friday night, and I'm all over UC dates. I'm back and forth in St. Louis, anywhere in middle America right now, touring in a lot of legal states and Delta-friendly, smoke-friendly states, hippie to hippie. And I'm definitely on Vito Nappy Roots, or simply Vito Tisdale in your Google engine. You're going to find me on the Actuality Route. Just a proud father in a Kentuckian, and going to keep moving and doing what I do. And thank y'all for sharing your platform tonight.
Man, thank you for the gems, the jewels, the thoughtful treasures. I mean, the genius of gems and jewels. The wood fire of wisdom, you know, which we can sit, you know, with the log of learning. Vito, this has been, thank you. You're welcome back anytime. We appreciate this so, so much for the upliftment, for the insight, the intelligence, and the profound thoughtfulness. Thank you so much.
Man, thank you, and
big shout out to Angela too for making this happen.
Absolutely. So yeah, man, we appreciate you, man. Thank you so much. I think the frequency got him, King.
Ah yeah, man. You know how that be. That was the cue right there.
Yeah.
But yeah, man.
But anyway, man, yeah.
Appreciate the bill, man. We about to be up out of here. Catch us tomorrow night. We're going to be here again. And Friday, all the way up to Sunday, man, for episode 600, man. Let's go.
Yep. We out.
Which America do you want to live in? In Trump's America, abortion would be banned. He even brags about overturning Roe v. Wade.
I got rid of Roe v. Wade.
And he said women who obtain reproductive health care should be punished. In Biden's America, women make their own health care decisions. Biden, focused on our future. Trump will take us back. Which America do you want to live in? Paid for by Biden for President.
Hello, it is Ryan, and we could all use an extra bright spot in our day, couldn't we? Just to make up for things like sitting in traffic, doing the dishes, counting your steps, you know, all the mundane stuff. That is why I'm such a big fan of Chumba Casino. Chumba Casino has all your favorite social casino-style games that you can play for free anytime, anywhere with daily bonuses. That should brighten your day a little. Actually, a lot. So sign up now at chumbacasino.com. That's chumbacasino.com.
No purchase necessary. VGW Group. Void where prohibited by law. See terms and conditions. 18 plus.